Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon, ladies. Thank you. And it's a pleasure being here with all of you. Thanks a bunch, Shruti. Shruti, where are you? Yeah. Thanks a bunch for this workshop and what we can share in today's program. The title of the workshop is this, simply, Career Breaks, Not Heartbreaks Anymore. And what we're going to do in that is to understand how career breaks happen, do they happen, and of course they do happen. So, and are we prone to it? So is each one of us over here actually running the risk of taking a career break? And how do we, you know, what are some of the things that we can do to ensure that we kind of avoid it? Yeah, great. Okay, so first of all, a few hygiene checks. I just want you to, you know, give yourselves 100%. So your mobiles, laptops, are they all switched off or on silent? Please do that so that you don't get disturbed. Give 100% of yourself. 100% of yourself would mean that, you know, you're here 100%. You're not at home, you're not at your workplace, you're not somewhere else, but you're giving 100% of yourself to yourself right here. So that's, you know, giving 100% of yourself. And no low dosers. Now, I'm not talking about the dosing thing. I know we've all had a good, nice lunch, but it's not about dosing I'm talking about. I'm talking about something else. I don't know how many of you have read this book called We Are Like That Only by Rama Bijapurkar. You've read it? Great. In that book, she speaks about India being a land of low dosers, which means if the pack says 3 scoops, we'll only use 2 scoops. If the medicine says, you know, if the doctor says you have to take antibiotics for 5 days, after 3 days, we'll feel better and we'll say we don't need to take it anymore and we'll stop it. Am I right? Yes? Don't be that here in this program. Don't be a low doser. If I'm asking you to participate in something, give 100% of yourself to it, because you're going to be going through some exercises and we're going to be doing some little interventions for us to understand how we can actually manage, you know, career breaks if they happen and how to prevent them. So give 100% of yourself and be here and follow all my instructions. I am your tyrant for the next 1 hour. So please listen to me. And you must all have heard of, you know, where you have the hero jumping and, you know, fighting and, you know, he taking on some 300 people at the same time. Yesterday was our cult hero Rajinikanth's birthday, 12-12-12. And you know the things that Rajinikanth can do, yeah? So, so how do we believe that? We believe that because we have or we go through something called willing suspension of disbelief. So when your, you know, your logical mind comes up and asks you a question, you then say, no, no, this can happen. So I want you to go through that willing suspension of disbelief right here. So when we're talking facts, don't question them, but accept them, because you are going to be benefiting out of going through that process. Yeah? And it does not stop when it stops. You can write to me. That's my email ID up there, sr@avtarcc.com. Or you could go to our Facebook page, which is Facebook, you know, AVTAR IWIN, AVTARIWIN, which is a social enterprise that works towards women's workforce participation. We are a 7-year-old organization called FLEXI Careers India, which runs the AVTAR IWIN service. We started off as a small network of 200 women who wanted to take, you know, the break and not be penalized by it. So these were women professionals who were looking for, you know, that work-life integrated career. So today we grew, we've really grown, and we are at 26,000 women on the network at this point of time. And what we really do is we offer research-based solutions, not just to the woman professional, but also to corporates. So we partner with a number of organizations in their second career program. So we are working with IBM on their Bring Her Back. We work with Unilever in their Career by Choice program. We work with Microsoft in their Springboard program. We work with GE for their Restart program. We're working with Goldman Sachs for their Returnship program. So a number of programs which are all the second career programs of various organizations, we are working with and partnering with them. So what we now offer you, what I'm going to basically share with you, is the result of all of these 7 years of having interacted with thousands and thousands of women professionals, brilliant women, highly accomplished, very well educated, but at some point of time in their life, they go through that, you know, that crossroads, which probably leads them to take a break. And then what do? So taking the break might be difficult in itself, but returning after a break, believe me, it's really, really tough. So what do you do to ensure, A, that even if you are contemplating a break, how do you stay relevant? How do you make sure that you are current and you are updated on what's happening? And the second thing is, what are the small things that you can do to manage over those potholes or those speed breakers in your career? That's what the next 1 hour, you know, less than an hour is going to be. So stay with me as we go through this journey. Please familiarize yourself with this clock. It will constantly appear on your screen because we are going to be doing some timed exercises. So when the timed exercises happens, the clock will come, and at some point of time, it will remind you of your days in college when you had the alarm clock which went bip, 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 bip and just screamed like anything. That's what this clock is also going to do. So familiarize yourself with it and make sure that you are able to complete the activities within the specific time frame. Yeah? Now, let me just share with you some data. Yeah? Because we are talking about India, we are talking about women's workforce participation, and my organization, we work to ensure that this women's workforce participation goes up. So how does it really look? Let me take you back a couple of decades to 1992, when this was how things were. The population of India was about, 0.88 billion. We hadn't touched the 1 billion mark at that point of time. Women of that were a little less than 50%. Workforce participation rate of women was at 17%. So it was still under the 20% mark. And at that point of time, nobody was recording attrition figures because the economy was not so great, for attrition to become such a problem. So nobody was actually looking at attrition figures. Then LPG happened. I've just mentioned it as liberalization, but liberalization, privatization, globalization. That happened. And with it, it brought in a slew of industries which are women friendly, where women lend themselves better to performing those jobs. So when after that happened, this is the scenario today in 2012. The population of India, 1.2 billion, women, again, roughly 50% of that population. Workforce participation rate of women has jumped to 28% in the last two decades. But look at the annual attrition rate of women. It's 18% per annum, which means one out of roughly five women are tried out of the workplace. And look at the number that are tried before the age of 30. Which is why I must congratulate all of you, many of you who are within that age group, of between, say, 25 to 35, because you would really benefit out of, this session, this one, and the panel discussion which follows this. So if you look at it, 48% of all women are tried before the age of 30. That's roughly half of everybody who joins. So these are the shocking figures. But there's another side to this, and guess what that side is? There are, therefore, 1.5 million off-ramped women in India who are looking at making a re-entry into the workplace. So there is a lot of women who left the workplace, but there's this huge number of women who are looking at coming back into the workplace. So therefore, this is why it is relevant for organizations to look at second career programs. And this is why it's important for all of us, career-seeking women professionals, to stay updated on how should we manage the many potholes and speed breakers of our career. So if you look at women's workforce representation, very quickly, at entry, great numbers, 44%, and the IT, ITES, and BPO industry, which is basically the target audience that the Grace Hopper Celebration for Women in Computing addresses, they contribute a very high percentage. NASSCOM puts that number at roughly about 34%. 34% of all women, of all professionals in this industry are women. So you have close to 44% which are there at the entry level. At mid-level, it's about 27%. At senior level, 12%. And at top management, it's about 8%. And at board levels, the boards are very, very lonely places for women, because you find only 3 out of every 100 board members actually being women. This morning, we heard Kirtiga speak about, you know, how the women's workforce participation in India is really skewed. But this is the hard data. So if you look at the women's workforce participation per se, it's at around 28%. So obviously, there is something that's happening which is making women off-ramp, you know, at every point of time in their life. So there's going to be a study, the results of which will be shared in the panel discussion that comes immediately after this. But I'm just going to give you a sneak preview to just 2 aspects of that study. Shruti Kannan, who's the chairperson of the panel discussion that's happening immediately after this session, will be sharing the complete data on why women take breaks in IT. So you might really be interested. Those of you who are talent managers in your organization, you might really be keen on knowing why that's happening. But let me just share with you a few quick pointers there. Childbirth is seen as the most important career impacting event for a woman professional. 94% of respondents agree to that. And if you look at male respondents, 90% of them agree to that, and 95% of the women agree to that. So you have all the other reasons like spousal relocation, pregnancy, marriage, health issues, elder care. Elder care also is a very growing reason for why women exit the workplace. Higher studies. So you find that a very small percentage, just 23%, feel that women exit the workplace due to higher studies. So there are some differences between how the male respondents of the survey feel and the women. If you look at which aspects of the workplace actually adds to breaks, you know, especially among women in IT, the first one is, of course, lack of support systems at home. So that is, something that we all know. In fact, there's this popular joke which goes, behind every successful woman, there is a reliable maid. So it's not a husband, it's not a friend or anyone, it's a reliable, dependable maid who is the reason of the success of every woman professional. So if you look at it, you find that, you know, all of these contribute to the reasons why, you know, women actually take those breaks in IT. So let us just very quickly now assess how break prone you are. So I'm just going to request my colleagues to hand over a handout to you, which basically talks about, you know, it asks you a few questions. So I want you to be really honest and answer those questions. So it's going to take 5 minutes. So let me just request my colleagues to hand it over. all done. Now, just before we actually go into analyzing, you know, what our scores are, I just want to play a video. This is a video of Ms. Lena Nair, who is the head of HR for Unilever, and who's very recently got promoted and is moving to you know, London to head up one of their businesses there in HR. She had actually participated in our skill building initiative called the Segway Sessions. And here she is speaking about how real the whole aspect of the break is.
A little bit of context. Yeah? One is that we know that women on ramp and off ramp, we know that women step out of the corporate world. Yeah, there is research to tell us that, there's our daily lives to tell us that. I mean, there's research by Sylvia Ann Hewlett who says that 43% of all working women, all qualified women, take a break sometime in their career. You heard Geetu speak about a 9-month break, the people who go for 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 7 years, etc., etc. So women do leave the organization. And intuitively it makes sense, you know, the decade of 30s to 40s is the decade when people in the corporate world are expected to strengthen their credentials to hit the board of the company. And that's the decade which is hardest for women, because that's the decade you're trying to build a family, look after your aging parents. It seems like everything comes together and becomes the hardest to pursue careers in those years. And when you don't, and you're competing with others, men in this case, who are building their credentials day in, day out, putting 24 hours at work or whatever it takes. So it's so intuitively it makes sense. I mean, in my own life, my sister gave up a career for 18 years. Finance professional gave up a career for 18 years. I think when my niece went to university, I asked my sister, now what's your excuse? I mean, 18 years I've heard this, you know. She's small, she needs me and blah, 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 12, 13. Now she's gone to university. She's like a million miles away. She's in Yale. Now you tell me what's your excuse. And then sort of it pours out, the lack of confidence, the lack of knowing whether the skills are relevant anymore, you know, the scare, the worry to compete. And I see it daily. I mean, you know, I've got her into a state where now she's confident, she's wanting to come back. But I've seen her go through that journey for 18 months. With all my HR skills, it took me 18 months to persuade her not to feel this lack of confidence, not to feel this apprehension. The other set of women, you know, when I look at the management trainees in HUL, we, you know, were 6 or 7 women who joined together. I'm the only one who's actively pursuing a career. There's one more who's working a little flexibly, and 5 more who've completely forgotten what a corporate world looks like. Some of them even think they don't want to get back there. Yeah? And that's a choice that you make. So the point I want to make is, it is, women do leave. We know that. Corporate world earlier was not cognizant of that, was not wanting to make the concessions for that. But today, I feel grateful that in my lifetime, I'm seeing people in the organization change. I'm seeing leaders change. I'm seeing the corporate world change and saying, how do we make this work for the 1.5 million women or some such number of women out there who are talented, can contribute, but are just seeking a platform to come back, are seeking some support to come back. So, you know, I can't tell you what a lovely time it is and how good you should feel that you're going to be a pioneering set of women in the next few years who will make this possible and inspire many, many women.
Now let's get to scoring it. So if you look at your sheet, there are some questions which are an option 1 and there are some questions which are an option 2 and there are option 3s. So score yourself this way. Give yourselves a 2 for every option 1, a 1 for every option 2, and 0 for any 3s that you might have chosen. Are you done? Are we all done? Great. Now, do all your scores, you know, add up and come to a number which is below 40? Is it all below 40? Okay, now here is the moment of truth. If you have scored between 30 to 40, congratulations. You are absolutely at the lowest possible risk of taking a break in your career. So those of you who have scored between 30 to 40, you really deserve to pat yourselves on the back and say a big hurrah, because that means you're not going to take a break any soon. So congratulations, and you're quite the role model. And I've said there, watch out. All companies here will headhunt you because you're showing that amount of career aspiration, which means that you're not likely to take a break. If you have scored between 20 to 30, good news, you're at a lower risk of a career break, but ensure that you stay connected with your area of expertise, your craft, what you're good at, what you're passionate about, and also pay due attention to strengthening your network and staying relevant in the industry. So that's what, if you've scored between 20 to 30. If you've scored between 10 to 20, caution, you're at a risk of taking a career break sooner than you possibly think. Make sure you're fully involved in building bridges and connections. So this group is probably at a high risk. And if you've scored between a 0 to 10, then the break is just around the corner. So you really have to focus on ensuring that you do these three things. Put down a clear plan on what you can do and how you can stay connected with your industry and your workplace. You know, whether you've already taken the break or you're going for it. Begin writing a list of all the things that you want to do but never had the time to do. You might as well utilize your break really well. And enjoy this workshop and build on the art of staying connected with those who matter to you. So that's a quick sort of exercise on what to do, you know, with regard to your break risk quotient. If you look at the whole point of why are there so few women in the workplace in India, you find that the first answer that, you know, most people hear is, you know, it's the old boys club. Women just can't do it. We can't do it, you know. Men have been creating those rules. Men are the ones who have created the whole clockwork of careers right now. I mean, it has to be a man who figured out that you have to be at work from 9 to 6 while children come back from school at 3 o'clock. You know, it had to be men who, you know, designed that. So obviously, it's about the old boys club. Work-life challenges. So that obviously, you know, leads to the fact that you would have multiple work-life challenges abounding. The fact that we have so few female role models. So when Kirtiga spoke in the morning, the thing that came to my mind and which stuck in my mind was the fact that among all those decisions which she had taken, the tough decisions in her life, the toughest was when she had to put her few weeks old baby into daycare. So obviously, you know, when someone does all of that and becomes a role model, obviously it's a very, very small and scary space out there, because there are very few of them. So that is the other reason why women are not able to really hack it in the workplace. And finally, women are seen to have very poor networking skills. I don't know, there's something about women, and especially Indian women that I've seen this, you know, which makes them very networking averse. We're not interested in it. So one of the things that we're going to do in this workshop is trying to crack that. So if you look at the key enablers of women's careers, I think the screen is far too big, but I'm just going to read out the, you know, the ones in the corner for you. So you have the hygiene and safety requirements which all women require. Sorry. You have the engagement and retention requirements again. You have, you know, the talent and growth, talent development requirements, and you have leadership requirements. These career enablers are a result of a study which we conducted. And, you know, about 500 women participated in this. And they enumerated the things that they want as career enablers, which will actually help them stay engaged in a career. So they sort of rated this like a Maslow's hierarchy of needs. So right at the bottom, you have the hygiene requirements, like things like an anti-sexual harassment committee, a workplace health and safety policy, maternity benefits. These are basic. These are absolutely the essential, I mean, you know, the price of admission aspects. Then you have the retention and engagement requirements, things like skill building initiatives, flexible working. daycare and crèche arrangements and all of that, which are the next level of enablers that women need. After that, you have the growth and talent development requirements, where you have cross-functional training, you have movements into a line staff role, where you get better exposure, and you have things like how do you actually build diversity into your own resume, into your own experience. All of that relate to the growth aspects, and finally leadership requirements. So what happened was, when we asked women to rate these, they divided them into two parts. One part was those requirements which are self-initiated, which I can do for myself in my own career. And the second part were those which the organization would do for you. So you divided these career enablers into self-initiated and organization-initiated. And the one commonality that we found among both sets of requirements was, if you used networking very effectively, then you got better results out of both self-initiated as well as organization-initiated requirements. That was the one commonality. So you found that at a skill-building program, you were able to do better if you were networking more and you learned from people around you. Similarly, in having a supportive peer group, how do you build a supporting peer group? You need to network more for it. So all of these things, showed that networking was that one aspect which combined the best of both enablers, both the organization-led enablers as well as the individual or the self-initiated enablers. So if you look at it, break or no break, what are the things that women need to do to stay relevant? And this comes from having interacted with at least about 20 of the 26,000 women on our network, because we tend to meet all of them, we tend to counsel most of them, on a one-on-one basis. And what are the things that they feel, women need to do for themselves to stay current and relevant in their careers? First is constant upskilling. Are you learning something every day, if not at least every month, if not at least every quarter? Have you learned something at work? Have you learned something, even if it's not at work, have you signed up for a program? Have you added an additional dimension to yourself? That's constant upskilling. The second is, how do you build executive presence? So this whole thing of executive presence, it's not just about the way you are groomed or how you look or, not that part of it. It's about the whole aspect of sounding like someone that people can take seriously. It's about, actually being someone that people respect and look up to. That is executive presence. Sorry. And then, the fact that you need mentors. Whether you have a break, whether you're taking a break or not, the fact that mentors can actually make all the difference in your career is the other thing that came up, as a very, very big career enabler. And finally, it's about networking. And how do we do the skill of networking? What do we do? How do we sort of demystify it? That's what we're going to do next. So if you look at the essence of networking, I'm sure all of you know it. Right here in this conference, all of us are doing it. We are networking with each other. We are, making new friends. We are asking people about what they do. But if you put it all together and you imagine any event, imagine any situation where you go and you're having to interact with people, what is the essence of good networking? It would be something that's genuine, where you're saying something and you're sounding genuine, but you are really genuine too. So you're saying something that's absolutely the thing that you're thinking. It's realistic in number, in the sense that, when you go for a networking event, you can't expect to come away carrying sheets of visiting cards, because that won't make any, sense to you. You focus on a realistic number of people that you can actually impact and you can leave a memory with. They should remember you and recall you. That is the other thing. It's not just about being, in person. It's not just about, making that network count in physical person. It's also virtual. Today, every single mode that you can think of in social media helps and aids networking, especially of women. It can be non-intrusive. It can be consistent. It can be genuine. You have a Facebook page. You have a LinkedIn account. You're talking about, you're on Twitter and you're tweeting all the time. So what is the kind of social media presence that you have? And are you making it count? Are you carrying your Facebook ID in your signature? And are you making your Facebook page as much about your professional self as it is about your personal life? So please remember, anything out there in the social media that's there permanently cannot be deleted. So how much of it are you sharing? What are you actually, you know, revealing of yourself in the social media, and how are you utilizing it to further your own career prospects and basically the whole art of networking? And finally, it's just about the old-fashioned method of making friends. The person that I know in my life who, you know, is a complete role model with regard to networking is my grandmother. She's 90 years old, and you know, the kind of effortless ease with which she would network in terms of, you know, going around, whether it's in a wedding or it's at any event or it's at a, you know, Carnatic music program that she goes to, she would remember everybody. She would know what it is to, you know, be the person that she's talking to. And she would ask them the relevant question. That genuinity is something that really helps her. And today, she is more connected with people around the world than I am. They're all her relatives, and everybody wants to stay in touch with her. So the essence of networking is about making friends. Now, I have a, you know, video that I want to share over here with you. I don't know how many of you watch The Big Bang Theory. Yeah. So in the, this is a small slice from The Big Bang Theory. I don't know how many of you watched the episode on the friendship algorithm. Okay, if you haven't, then you're going to find this very interesting. I'm just going to play it for you. Do we all know the, for the ones who don't know, The Big Bang Theory is about four or five friends, you know, who are all typically the nerds, the geeks. So they are the ones, and they are, you know, and over here, one of the characters is actually trying to make friends with a colleague at the workplace. And what he has done is he has actually gone to a children's library and picked up a book called Stu the Cockatoo, who is new at the zoo. So this book is about a cockatoo which, you know, got into the zoo newly and how he makes friends. So this is going to be, you know, he then, what he does, the character, he distills the whole thing into an algorithm. And let's just watch what he does with this whole thing.
Good, you're just in time. I believe I've isolated the algorithm for making friends.
Sheldon, there is no algorithm for making friends.
Hear him out. If he's really onto something, we could open a booth at Comic-Con, make a fortune.
See, my initial approach to Kripke had the same deficiencies as those that plagued Stu the Cockatoo when he was new at the zoo.
Stu the Cockatoo?
Yes, he's new at the zoo.
It's a terrific book. I've distilled its essence into a simple flow chart that will guide me through the process.
Have you thought about putting him in a crate while you're out of the apartment?
Hello, Kripke. Yeah, Sheldon Cooper here. It occurred to me that you hadn't returned any of my calls because I hadn't offered any concrete suggestions for pursuing our friendship. Yeah, perhaps the two of us might share a meal together. Yeah, I see. Well, then perhaps you'd have time for a hot beverage. Popular choices include tea, coffee, cocoa. I see. No, wait, don't hang up yet. But what about a recreational activity? I bet we share some common interests. You tell me an interest of yours. Really? On actual horses? Tell me another interest of yours. Oh, no, I'm sorry. I have no desire to get in the water till I absolutely have to. Tell me another interest of yours.
Uh-oh, he's stuck in an infinite loop.
I can fix it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's interesting, but isn't ventriloquism by definition a solo activity? Yeah. Wait, tell me another interest of yours. Is there any chance you like monkeys? Yeah, what is wrong with you? Everybody likes monkeys. Hang on, Kripke. A loop counter and an escape to the least objectionable activity. Howard, that's brilliant. I'm surprised you saw that.
Gee, why can't Sheldon make friends?
All right, Kripke, that last interest strikes me as the least objectionable, and I would like to propose that we do that together. Tomorrow. Yes, I'll pay. All right, goodbye.
So that was Sheldon Cooper trying to make friends using a friendship algorithm, and he was going into a never-ending loop because he was trying to find out a common area of, you know, passion or activity, and nothing, you know, common was actually coming up. So if his friend hadn't sort of stepped in and done a loop counter over there, you know, he might have sort of perpetually gone on trying to find out those qualities. So what typically happens is, you know, if you put too much of a structure into it, see, this workshop is about networking, it's about making friends, it's about trying to see how you can actually stay relevant even while you are considering a break, or, you know, to prevent that break. But a lot of it has to flow very naturally from yourself. So to that extent, what is critical is how do you do it in your own style? What is your own style for it? So how do you really make your connections work? It's definitely a two-way street. So it's not something that, you know, you can do by yourself. It has to come from the other side, and there has to be a whole lot of effort from your side as well. So for this, let's go back to the Johari window. How many of us know about the Johari window? It's 1, 2, 3. Okay, there are a few of you, so I'm going to sort of explain about the Johari window over here. The Johari window actually is a square which is split into four quadrants. And in each of the quadrant, what you typically see is how much, you know, you reveal of yourself and how much is known by others. So the first area, which is the open area, is known by both self and others. So I'm here in front of you. There is a profile of me in the, you know, the Grasshopper guide. So if you read through it, all that is there in the open area is right there. There's a Wikipedia link if you, you know, type my name. And you will find everything about my history, early childhood, all of that. And that's the open area. But if you look at the blind area, then that is something that others know about you, but which you don't know about yourself. So this is where feedback helps. This is where when somebody tells you, hey, you know what, you have that. And it's news to you. You never realized that that was how it was before. That is the blind area. And then the third is the hidden area. The hidden area is where you have information that you keep to yourself and the others do not know about it. So that's the hidden area which you keep to yourself, which is known to self but unknown to others. And the final one is the dark area, which is not mentioned here, which is the unknown area or the dark spot, which is known neither to yourself nor to others. So that's completely sort of hidden. So the essence of networking, dear friends, is about how large your open area is. How do you actually work towards increasing that open area? How much of others, you know, do you know, and how much of yourself do you share with others? That is the whole concept of and the principle of networking. So this is my Johari window. You know, a lot of things I discovered very recently about myself. And so quickly moving on, what we're now going to do is we're going to actually put into practice what it is that, you know, we are learning over here. I'm going to request you to fill up a form. You know, my colleagues are just going to sort of hand it over to you now. If you look at that form, it has a sheet in which there are a lot of, you know, columns over there. And these are the four columns, right? It's the name, favorite city, favorite food, latest success at work, and pet peeve at her office. These are what you're going to find out about other women in this hall. So there are, yes? Sorry? What's a pet peeve? Something that bugs her. Something that irritates the person that you're talking to. So I'm just going to clock you now. Within 10 minutes, I'm going to see which of you is able to complete that form. Which means you need to quickly go around the hall, speak to someone, find their name, find out the favorite city of that person, favorite food, latest success at work, and finally, their pet peeve. Okay? Your time starts now. You get 10 minutes. Quickly. Let's just see you moving around. You don't have a pen? Must be there in your bag. it's not yours. You shouldn't write about yourself. It's about the women that you're talking to. It's about the women sitting next to you. It's about the women in the last row. It's about your friends around. I don't see you even getting up. How are you going to network if you're sitting down at a place? 25 people. Come on, ladies. So are you going row by row? You're finishing up one row and then going to the next? Any? Two. Okay, we are already 3 minutes down. You have only 7 minutes more to. So time up. Ladies, please get back to your seats. Please get back to your seats. We have a lot more to go. Please come back quickly. Please settle down. Ladies, you're done with the networking. Now it's during the tea break. Please come back. Come back. Thank you. Thank you. Please come back. Please resume your seats. So can I know people who have got more than 5 names in your list? Wow, great. Okay, within 10 minutes you are able to make 5 new friends. Are they new friends or are they old friends? Old friends don't count. They have to be new friends. Okay, more than 10 names on your page. More than 10 names on your page. More than 9 names on your page. 9, 8. Okay, I guess you are the winners over here. Congratulations, the two of you. Your names, please, young ladies. Sorry? Kritika and Lydia, congratulations. A big round of applause to the two people who managed 8 contacts. Okay, in some of the sessions that we have run this, we've actually had people completing the entire 25 within those 10 minutes. It's like quickly, running and having a strategy for it, which is what we're now going to see. So if you look at why we network, the basic question, it's for 2 reasons actually. One is to create spheres of influence, which we need for buy-in for projects, to create and identify coaches, to have mentors. That's why we need, which is to create spheres of influence. And the second is to create information power for ourselves. This is the primary need or the objective of networking. And when we have that information power, it leads to access to opportunities. It helps us upgrade ourselves and actually stay relevant. So if you look at the problems with networking, it's actually not a problem with networking per se. It's a problem with unstructured networking. So many of us go to events like this, conferences. We go to meetings, we go to our own, organizations, town halls and all that. But you know what we end up doing? We end up doing this. We end up talking to the people that we already knew, which is what you did right now, yes? You ended up talking to those who you knew. What is the benefit of it? It doesn't give you any kind of a fresh perspective, does it? And what does it mean? It means it's pointless chit-chat. You ask the same questions to the same people whenever you meet them again. Oh, lovely, sorry, and oh my God, it's so good to see you. Yeah, those are nice, interpersonal glue. the thing that you have to make, small talk, which helps. But if your entire networking for that half an hour is only small talk, then how are you going to benefit out of it? And we have these oft-repeated conversations with the same people, you know, which don't develop the relationship at all. Wherever you left off, you would sort of pick it up from there, and it would still be pointless. So that is what happens when you have an unstructured networking experience, which is the content is not powerful enough to leave a strong impression. What happens when you do structured networking? You meet people who you otherwise would not meet. You would have conversations with contacts which you would probably not have otherwise. You would get insights into people's characters, you know, and competence, which you probably otherwise won't know. There are no ho-hum discussions, you know, no boring stuff. And you get a lot of fresh energy from people, you know, and from new points of view that you never knew about previously. So this, structured networking is something we have to practice and develop a style whereby you follow these things. You know, how do you meet people you don't normally, you know, sort of meet? How do you have conversations? How do you get insights into people? And how do you get that fresh energy from, you know, points of view? So looking at structured networking, the few points which I want you to sort of, you know, focus on is identify suitable networking opportunities, prepare an information pool which would cross borders. See, you know that you're going to an event for networking purposes. Yes, you will listen to sessions like this, you would listen to workshops and panel discussions. But where does your career and where does the actual, that grit get built during a networking event? It's when you network. It's when you meet new people. It's when you talk about yourself. Yeah? So for that, you need to be an interesting conversationalist. You need to be someone who is interesting to somebody else. For that, information is important. Ideally, have at least one or two people that you already know within the event. Find out if somebody else is coming. Find out that if there are common friends that you'd be meeting there. But more importantly, go to events where you do not know many people. What's the point in going to a place where you already know? If the purpose is networking, right? Then go to events where you don't know anybody at all. Prepare your most compelling introduction, which is also known as the elevator pitch. I don't know, how many of you actually have an elevator pitch? Great, two of them out of the whole hall. Please prepare an elevator pitch. An elevator pitch is a very simple thing. It's a 2-minute introduction about yourself. Something that you would talk with a person, you know, if you're riding up the elevator and the person has to get off at the next floor and you have just those 2 minutes to impress him or her, what would you say? That's the elevator pitch. Please prepare it. Rehearse. So the first time you say that elevator pitch doesn't come out really nicely. So when I have done networking quite a bit and meet a new person, I used to say all kinds of things. I'm Saundarya, Rajesh, I'm married, I have 2 children. Various things which probably were not relevant to the person that I'm meeting. Today when I meet someone, I say, I run an organization that works for women's workforce participation. So immediately I get the attention of the person that I'm talking to because it's a universal thing. But did I come to that line very easily? No. It took me a lot of time to actually figure out what would be the most powerful introductory statement that I could make about myself. So if you look at relationships, this is how relationship gets built. You know, they don't know you by name, they know you by name, they are friendly with you, they like you, they respect you, and finally, they value that relationship with you. This is the path that networking has to take. And in order to make this path very effective, and I'm very conscious of time, I think we have just about 10 minutes more, what we are going to do is, we are going to find out how we can, in a structured manner, actually leverage the benefit of relationships. So everybody that you meet is an accident, right? The person sitting next to you, you are sitting on 14B in the plane. The person sitting in 14A is an accident. You don't know that person and there was nothing, you know, meant to actually make them sit next to you. An acquaintance, however, is someone that you share something in common with, yeah, and you can reach out to them. An associate is somebody that you've interacted with and that you can, you know, constantly actually go back to. An advocate is somebody who actually supports you and would speak on your behalf. And an ally is someone who is your own, on your own personal board of directors. So the idea of networking is to have a significant number of allies, a large number of advocates, an even more greater number of associates, and a good pool of acquaintances from whom you would be able to derive your allies. So this is the first group that we need to focus on, the acquaintances who we convert into associates. The group two would be the associates who you convert into advocates, and group three are the advocates who you convert into allies. So I'm just going to request my colleagues to hand over, you know, a form to you. I think you probably, some of you would already have it. This form is for you to reflect. I mean, if you can, you know, fill it up right here, right now, that's great. But if you want to take it back home and reflect upon it, then please do so. This is the power of nine. What does it really mean? It means that you choose three people in your first group who are acquaintances. Today, they are mere acquaintances. So this first group, you have, you know, probably met, but you've just met them fleetingly. You can reconnect again with them because you have somebody in common. Just as an example, think of a school teacher you met at your friend's wedding. You spent a good time, you know, with her that day, but you don't have a contact details. But you can you know, always speak to your, you know, your sister or your friend and obtain her connect again. Which is, and typically people that you meet in a conference like this. So they are acquaintances who you have met briefly. So name three people who are acquaintances who you would like to convert to associates. So who are your associates? Associates are people that you see frequently. For example, a colleague or a neighbor, someone you know who you have regular interaction with. Studies show that it takes six contacts, six good conversations with this, you know, with anybody before they become an associate. So the associate would be a great resource for you, you know, who you can tap into for information, for advice, for opinion, and so on. So name three people in your list who are associates, who are already associates, who you want to convert into advocates. Now the final group are advocates. An advocate is an associate whom you have established trust. Yeah? An advocate is someone who knows you so well that when he or she sees an opportunity for you that would appeal to you, they take action. She takes action on your behalf. I'm sure all of us have, you know, people who are our advocates. Let me just share an example, you know, of what happened today. There is Malathi of Cisco who, you know, knows me for a long time. But today when she found someone that she believed would be interested in my work and who she believed would be of benefit to me, she actually took me to that person and she made me stand there and she did an elevator pitch about me. She said, here is Saundarya Rajesh. They run an organization that works with second career women professionals. She runs workshops. She runs training programs, sensitization programs for men and women, second career programs, all of that. She delivered the pitch so powerfully on my behalf. So she had actually become an advocate of mine. So in that sense, how many people can you identify who are currently your associates, but who you would convert to advocates? So write in your sheet the names of your nines. If you want to, you know, sort of think about it some more, please take it home and write about it. But this is what you're going to be doing. You will create a calendar. And please do this because you need to invest in yourself. So please create a calendar. You know, it could be on your laptop, it could be on your mobile, wherever. But create a calendar where you will earmark time to network with your nines. Actually mention it. Call Sheila and put it on reminder. Because only then we will actually make time to do that activity. The time spent has to be on mutual consent. If Sheila doesn't answer the phone when you call, you'll have to call her back. It has to be mutually agreeable. Update and get feedback from that person on what you're doing. Send out a mail. Facebook and other social networking, you know, media are so good for this because they allow you to speak about what you're doing. It could be, you know, a passion, it could be a business, it could be your the current project you're working on in your career, but it helps you network and connect and update and get feedback on your activities. I'm doing this. What do you think of it? So a person who is your nine, who's one of your nines, will actually give you that feedback. And you can ask them, what is happening? Do you think I'm in the right track? Do you think this is good? So then that means you've moved that relationship forward, you know, to that of an ally. So you have to review your nines after 6 months. Promise yourself that you would do it. Because only when you review your nines, you will know if you are proceeding in the right direction with regard to actually benefiting out of networking. So the do's and don'ts of networking, I'm not going to go into it in detail here. But if you visit our Facebook page, you will have a copy of this list there and you can just download it from there. If you just visit avtarivin.com, you will have the do's and don'ts of networking there. So the end goal of networking, dear ladies, is the creation of allies. That is the one final, what shall I say, aim or objective or goal of the whole process of networking. It is to ensure that you have enough allies around you. And who is an ally? An ally is on your personal board of directors. An ally is someone who will do all they can to help you reach your goal. And women, simply because they are prone to taking more breaks than men, and simply because they need more allies in the workplace, considering that they are recent entrants, need all the allies that they can. If you look at the Indian woman's career, it's like snakes and ladders. Yeah? So you climb and then you come down and then you go up again. So this is typically how I would represent the Indian woman's, you know, sort of career line. But if you look at what kind of snakes are there, these are some of the snakes. Okay, I don't want to say that family value could be a snake, but believe me, many women who have interacted with me have said, I don't want to work because my husband believes I shouldn't earn more than him. It's a family value. What do? You have to accept it. So that's why I made it a snake and I put it over there. But if you look at the ladders, you have so many ladders there. Networking is one of the most prominent ladders that would help a woman professional actually, you know, go up in her life. So many other things, including flexible working, re-entry opportunities for women, supportive peers, all of these also are ladders for a woman. So what we do, I'm just closing up here. We run India's first skill-building initiative for women professionals called the Segway Sessions. The page, our Avatar Ivan page, is a resource. You will find a lot of information on it with regard to how women can actually, you know, progress in their career. It will give you thoughts, opportunities, ideas. Please follow it. And remember, interact with more people. Interact with diverse professional contacts. Commit to expanding your knowledge. Keep an open mind because you don't know when your next networking opportunity which will actually happen. And this is personally from me to you, make it your goal to have more friends in the year 2013. Happy New Year and wish you all the very best. Thank you. Just take 2 minutes to fill up the feedback forms which we have given to you. Kindly fill it in and our, you know, colleagues will come across and they will collect it from you. Thank you, ladies. It's been a pleasure.